Hello and welcome to today's session, and we are going to discuss the factor analysis. This is one of the most important analysis that we use and this technique is described as factor analysis, and usually this is referred to as interdependence analysis, and it's a bit different from regression and discriminant analysis. And there is no concept of predicting over here, and there is no dependent variable which depends on some independent variables. So factor analysis is most widely applied to multivariate technique of research, especially in the field of social and behavioral sciences. Now this technique described in this lecture as factor analysis, mainly it tries to examine the systematic interdependence among a set of observed variables, and the researcher is mainly focused on determining the basis or base of commonality among these variables. Okay, so this is quite different from the previous lectures where we had studied about regression and all. There is nothing as such where there is any concept of prediction and all are missing over here. Okay, let's get deeper into it and try to understand what this entire analysis is. Okay, this is going to be really very, very important. So stay focused, stay attentive. Now, what is the relevance of factor analysis? It's a multivariate data analysis technique. Lot of variables are there, so it's a multivariate data analysis technique. Then each carrying numerous dimensions, each of the variables, they have multiple numerous dimensions. Okay, and then it is a data reduction technique. We may have 20 or 30 different statements. Through using this technique we can reduce them to 3 or 4 maybe. Okay, so this is a data reduction technique. And this could be very, very useful when we are trying to study the perceptions or psychographics. Okay, this is the relevance. Now, these are the conditions and important terms. Now, we need metric data. This analysis cannot be applied on non-metric or categorical data. When I say metric data, it refers to interval scale or ratio scale. Okay. So the data has to be interval or ratio. Then independence technique. Now they have to be statistically independent. The sample size has to be greater than 60. Number of statements should ensure compliance with n condition. And the Bartlett's test of sphericity, for which the chi square has to be statistically significant. And the H0 in this case, that would be correlation matrix, is identity matrix. Okay, now the various conditions that has to be taken care of: KMO values should be greater than 0.5. KMO is a very important statistical measure that you would find in this test. You have to ensure that the KMO value is greater than 0.5, without which you cannot progress or proceed with factor analysis. And anti-image correlation should be low, eigenvalue should be greater than 1, percent of variation should be greater than 60%, and criteria for conversion of variables in factors, factor loading should be there, rotation methods and commonalities. These are the important conditions, important things that you have to check while you are doing the factor analysis. We'll discuss all of them. Okay, now factor analysis, this is a technique which is multidimensional scaling and correspondence analysis, and they are often referred to as interdependence analysis. Okay, we have several statements which are interdependent on one another, so we reduce them and club them into one single statement, and that's the reason we check for interdependence. The main focus of factor analysis is to summarize the information contained in a large number of variables into a few small number of factors. Okay, that's what I have been telling you right from the beginning. And the number of factors or the factor analysis allows a researcher to group the variables into a number of factors based on the degree of correlation among the variables. Okay, so based on the degree of correlation, the software, primarily SPSS, bundles them into one significant factor. Okay, thus the factor analysis is a statistical technique used to determine the prescribed number of uncorrelated factors, where each factor is obtained from a list of correlated variables. Okay, I have a bunch of variables, and when they have strong correlation, they are clubbed under one factor, and there is no correlation between one factor to the other factor. Okay, now mathematically this is how I express the factor analysis, that is Fi is equal to Ai x1 plus Ai2 x2 plus Ai3 x3 and so on till Ain xn, where Fi is the estimate of the ith factor and Ai the weights of factor score coefficients, and n is the number of variables. Okay, through the figure you can understand this is how factors are created. Now it is important that you note that for forming a factor F1, each variable, that is x1 or x2, which is correlated with other variables, share some variance with those other variables. This is referred as commonality in factor analysis. Okay, so there has to be some variance with other variables. Now in F1 I have x2, x3, x4, it should have some variance with x1 or x6 or x5 maybe. Okay, that is what is commonality. Some basic terms that you have to remember in factor analysis: one is correlation matrix. Okay, in the output from the SPSS you can see this correlation matrix. It is a simple correlation matrix of all the pairs of variables included in the factor analysis. It simply gives you the correlation coefficients, the R values of all the variables that you have used in the problem. Then I have the Kaiser-Meier-Olkin measure of sampling adequacy. Okay, this statistic shows the proportion of variance for variables included in the study in the common variance. Okay, it has to be greater than 0.5. A high value of KMO indicates the appropriateness of factor analysis for the data in hand. Then I have Bartlett's test of sphericity, which tells us, okay, this statistic tests the hypothesis whether the population correlation matrix is an identity matrix or not. Now communalities, now it indicates the amount of variance a variable shares with all other variables taken in the study. And eigenvalue, it indicates the proportion of variance explained by each factor. Okay, so these are some definitions, you just have to read them, they are quite obvious. And then percentage of variance, it gives the percentage of variance that can be attributed to each specific factor relative to the total variance in all the factors. Scree plot, it's a plot of eigenvalues. Okay, I'll show you one scree plot so you can understand. This is quite important, it gives you a visual impact of how many factors to keep in your output. Wherever you find the steepest drop, so anything before the steepest drop, you keep those many factors. Okay, when you see it you will easily understand. Now factor loadings, they are also known as factor variable correlations. Now these are a simple correlation between the variables, so nothing to worry about it. Factor matrix, the factor matrix table contains the factor loadings of each variable taken from the study on unrotated factors. Then factor score, it represents a subject's combined response to various variables representing the factor. Now we assign some score. Okay, based on the score, what we do is, it's the subject's combined response to various variables representing the factor. And then factor loading plot, it is a plot of original values which use factor loadings as coordinates. Now these are the process, this is how the step-by-step process how we conduct the factor analysis. Now in step one, you do the problem formulation. Okay, you identify what the problem is and what you are expected to do or what you are targeting to do. Step two, construction and examination of correlation matrix. You construct and examine the correlation matrix, and then step 3, selection of an appropriate factoring technique. You try to figure out what are the appropriate factoring techniques. Okay. Now, usually, like, if I talk about the factoring techniques, there are some common factoring techniques that you can easily find in your SPSS, the basic software that we use, that is the SPSS. So we have some basic factoring techniques over there, and once you open the SPSS and you see what are the various factoring techniques, then you can easily figure out the most important or the most predominant factoring techniques, that is the principal component method. Okay, this is one of the most important one. This is one of the most popular one, and we usually use this, the principal component method. Okay, so you have to remember. And another important method is principal axis factoring. So primarily these are the two, the principal component method, the principal axis factoring. These are the two methods that we use for the factoring techniques. Then I come to the decision regarding the number of factors to be retained in the final solution. How many do I need to retain in the final solution? For this, usually we use the eigenvalue criteria. An eigenvalue criteria or eigenvalue is the amount of variance in the variable taken for the study that is associated with a factor. Now, according to this eigenvalue criteria, the factors having more than one eigenvalue are included in the model. So you have to remember this. All the factors which have more than one eigenvalue are included in the model. A factor that has an eigenvalue less than one is not better than a single variable, because due to standardization, each variable has a variance of one. So you have to take or consider only those factors which have an eigenvalue greater than one. Okay, and then you also can, you know, consider the scree plot criteria, one of the most important popular guides for determining how many factors should be retained in the factor analysis is the scree plot. And I will show you that scree plot. Then this is the scree plot. Okay, now you can see I have a steep fall after this. Okay, so factor 1, factor 2, then a steep fall, then factor 3, 4, 5. So after which factor do I have the steepest fall? So I retain only those. So I'll retain only two factors and I'll ignore all these. These factors can be excluded from the model, and these two factors are going to be retained in the model. Okay, now this is how we consider, or this is how we keep the number of factors using the scree plot. Okay, then I have factor rotation for enhancing interpretability of the solution. Okay, interpretability, sometimes it's difficult to pronounce, but you know, interpretable is how do you interpret. Now, after selection of factors, the immediate step is to rotate the factors. Now, rotated simple structure solutions are easy to interpret, that is understand, whereas the originally unextracted or unrotated factors are often difficult to interpret. A rotation is required because the original factor model may be mathematically correct but may be difficult in terms of interpretation. So for this reason, what we do is, if various factors have a high loading on the same variable, then interpretation will be extremely difficult. Rotation solves this kind of interpretation difficulty. Okay, so now what you have to do is factor rotation. Okay, next is substantive interpretation. Substantive interpretation is, at this stage, there is a point of identity. The factors with concerned variables as the constituents of the factors. Now, what we usually do is this. It is important to interpret and how the component transformation matrix, okay, the component transformation matrix is used to construct the rotated factor matrix. from the unrotated factor matrix by using a simple formula maybe, and for where unrotated factor loading into factor transformation matrix is equal to rotated factor loadings. So you can note down this formula: unrotated factor loading multiplied by factor transformation matrix is equal to rotated factor loadings. So in this case, in which off diagonal elements are close to zero indicates a relatively smaller rotation, and off diagonal elements are larger, that is greater than plus or minus 5, indicate a relatively larger rotation. Okay, so that is substantive interpretation. Now finally, you have to check the model fit. Now how do we check the model fit? That is, we have to determine the fitness of factor analysis model. In factor analysis, the factors are generated on the basis of observed correlation between the variables. Now the degree of correlation between the variables can be reproduced. Now for an appropriate factor analysis solution, the difference between the reproduced and observed correlation should be small, that is less than 0.05. You have to remember this, okay? This is very important point. Should I repeat? For an appropriate factor analysis solution, the difference between the reproduced and observed correlation should be small, that is less than 0.05, as can also be seen from the discussion that we had. Only, you know, that's very, very important that the residuals, whatever you get, should be greater than 0.05, which indicates that there is an appropriate factor analysis model, right? So I hope you have understood the entire process of conducting the factor analysis. This is going to be a very, very important process to follow. Please learn the step-by-step process. In the next lecture, we are going to discuss how to run the test on SPSS, and we'll understand the entire analysis using a practical problem. Okay, till then, you can get in touch with me on any of these social media links. You can follow me on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter. You can write to me directly at rajeshdurbala@gmail.com. This is a Facebook page. We are running an organization, that is Let Peace Proliferate. You can visit this page, www.facebook.com/letppro. And this is a fight against extremism. So do contribute in any form. Share your any experiences where you are subjected to any form or any sort of extremism. Till then, it was nice interacting with you. Thank you. See you soon.